We all know what low battery anxiety feels like. You hear that and you just get that itchy feeling in your brain because you want to look something up, but you can't, and you want to text, but you can't. Gah, stupid batteries. These little power packs run everything in our life these days, so understandably, people are obsessed with them. Every year, there's a new study saying, scientists finally did it, or new battery will blah, blah, blah. I've done so many battery videos over the years, and I'm done with the hype. I compiled a list of the hype-ist batteries, and instead of blathering on, I went to the source, Dr. Shirley Meng. Will any of these batteries actually revolutionize our technology anytime soon? We'll find out, but first I had to ask her, I mean, I didn't want to, but I had to. Why are batteries so bad?
I get this a lot from our friends, families, even, yeah. They blame on Shirley. Okay, you see, the battery is bad. As scientists, we don't mind this kind of challenge from the society at all. You know, in fact, that's what drives us to do more and do better. There are chemistries that can even fivefold higher energy density, like over 1,000 kilowatt hour per kilogram, so which is five times better than today's batteries. What I want to emphasize is that all the mobile devices that we're using now perform 20 times more functions than the flip phone that we had when we were little. The human desire for using electrons to obtain functionality and getting tasks done are insatisfiable. I think that people always wanted to do more.
She's right. If you think about what we can do with batteries today versus even 10 years ago, batteries are actually incredible. Maybe we just have this insatisfiable expectations. In my experience, that comes from not fully understanding what's up, which is honestly why I do what I do. Quick refresher. A battery is three things: an anode, a cathode, and an electrolyte. Charged particles move from anode to the cathode through the electrolyte to power things. For rechargeable batteries, we use the power from the wall to push those charged particles, called ions, back to the anode to store more energy. Each time we push the ions, we affect the life of the battery, taking a charge from 100% to zero, then back again, counts as one cycle. A good battery can do that several hundred, even thousands of times. Then lastly, the amount of electrical power the ions move around is the power we get from the battery. That's called specific energy. It's measured in watt-hours per kilogram. I know it's complicated, you don't need to know that. Just know, for our conversational purposes, more is better. Not all batteries are created equal. Right now, the queen of batteries is lithium-ion. It's in everything from EVs to power tools to scooters and cell phones. It peaks at a specific energy of 300, and it lasts thousands of cycles. And of course, it can also explode because the electrolyte is really volatile. So, we can do better. The Argonne National Laboratory in Chicago is a government research lab. They focus on all sorts of things, but one of their focuses is energy generation, storage, and technology. Shirley is working there to try and get these next generation batteries off the ground, sometimes literally, and I'm gonna go through each battery one at a time in order of hype.
First up, lithium sulfur?
You should expect some very exciting news coming from a program called the Battery 500. In the past, lithium sulfur can cycle only less than 100 cycles, and today there are very innovative method to make them cycle 300 or even 500 cycles. So we're making good progress. Lithium sulfur is one of our top choices for like some of the low-end electric mobility device.
Like a scooter or something that might just get like a last mile kind of device. Doesn't need to go 100 miles, needs to go 10.
Exactly.
Okay, Lithium-Air. It gets a lot of love, sounds kind of magical.
It is my dream if something like the two lightest elements, the lithium and oxygen, can actually work together. Yeah, we're not there yet. There's a lot of scientific challenges that are not resolved.
Look at that specific energy, more than 1,000? That's a kilowatt hour per kilogram, like powering your house for an hour using a battery the size of a few decks of cards. If they can get it to work, it could be five times better than lithium ion and lighter too. I'm getting caught up in the hype, aren't I? It sounds like magic, but it's just far off science. That said, Dr. Meng is working on something similar, sodium ion.
If you think about the periodic table, right? Hydrogen, lithium, next one is sodium in the group one. And the sodium is bigger, so then it's basically its energy density compared to lithium is a bit of inferior. Like slightly lower voltage and a lower energy density. However, I think with proper engineering design, it is actually possible to make sodium ions move faster than lithium. Big advantage for sodium batteries is that we first get rid of all the critical materials like lithium, cobalt. We don't even use copper if we use sodium. As a lot of people didn't know, United States is one of the biggest sodium ash deposits in the world. I would say that sodium batteries is rising up to the top priorities. So yeah, that's also a very active area that we are pursuing.
But chemistry is just one part of the problem. The other part is how batteries are constructed, how they're put together. We need a whole new design. Enter solid state batteries. These are the hype-ist beasts. Everyone is so charged up and positive about them, but they're not a battery chemistry as much as a battery design at this point.
Personally, I'm very fascinated by the potential possibilities solid state can offer. I think the dream for all of us is some of the pillars and the walls in your house is going to be batteries. Like you basically you can use as a structural component because they are so safe. If you expose it in the California sun, sometimes the temperature can go up to 110 Fahrenheit maybe. Solid state actually can work at a very high temperature and requires less thermal management. What I dream about is to make it last as long as the cogen turbines and the solar panels, because we are going to put them as part of the infrastructure. So the best way to kind of going infrastructure is you promise, you know, half a century service life.
You can see why solid state's the dream battery, right? You can integrate it into your house. It's not gonna catch fire like a shoddy Tesla. It'll work for 50 years or more, so many cycles. But the hype has a catch, of course.
The major challenge is that it requires a new way of manufacturing. So I think in the industry side, there's a lot of opposing voice because they already built up all the gigafactories. So like pivoting to a new type of architecture is very, very challenging.
In case you didn't catch that, what she means here is capitalism. Companies that make batteries built giant gigafactories to crank out lithium-ion batteries. Even though solid state are like the magic beans, lithium ions are the cash cow. They're not gonna sell their cow for beans. At least that's how I understand it. The point is, none of these revolutionary batteries are there yet. You know, they're not being made for us yet. Today, battery life is one of the top concerns for people buying things like electric cars and cell phones. These technologies are supposed to drive innovation in battery technology, but lithium ion is still queen. This is 2023, new phones and laptops and cars and handheld devices, they come out every year. So why do batteries take so long?
Building batteries is not like writing computer software codes. You know, building actual hardware is always very difficult. It takes time, dedications, and for batteries particularly, you know, I want to say that the investment in talents and in materials, I think everything come together, then we will be able to do it.
Right now, these new batteries that you see in shorts and nerdy TikToks, they're all hype and theory and papers and experiments, but they could change that. One physicist told me at some point you have to stop theorizing and build it, then nature will tell you what happens. Engineers and researchers are working on this day in and day out, but they have to build them to make sure they work. Then they have to mine all that material and they have to be rolled into the supply chain and then put into technology, that can take years. Real science moves way slower than television. So keeping it in reality and not on the hype train, the average mobile phone battery has a specific energy of about 200. Imagine a battery like lithium air pulling five times that.
We will need batteries for different niche applications. Batteries serve the grid, maybe different from the batteries from the EV, and maybe different from the mobile device, and maybe different from the Internet of Things.
Now imagine the reverse, a battery equal in power to your phone, but five times smaller.
Because I've seen some very good like miniaturization of batteries that can enable wearables where you don't even know that you're wearing them.
Wearable batteries could be hidden in your clothes to, I don't know, adjust the fit of your jacket or your shoes. Power laces, I always wanted to do that. That was supposed to be 2015, by the way, as seen from the 1980s, meaning if you fast forward to 2050, it's the same gap. Our tech is gonna seem so dated and our batteries will be a big part of that. Maybe the most big part. And in order to get to a place where we only use batteries to power things, we're going to need a lot of batteries.
How many batteries are we going to need?
My prediction was 400 terawatt hour, and Elon Musk, Tesla's prediction was 280 terawatt hour.
Let me pump the regenerative brakes here. Shirley is saying to transition to a battery-powered renewable infrastructure, we'll probably need 400 terawatt hours of battery capacity. Terawatts! That is a huge amount of storage.
Today, our world production is about 1 terawatt hour, close to 2 now, per year.
Okay, whoa. Okay, it's gonna take us a minute then.
To achieve that might take a century of effort, unless we really put some cash where our kilowatts are, if you know what I mean. It's about resources and effort. We can have hundreds of scientists who want to do something, but without the resources, it'll never happen. If you flip that, unlimited resources don't necessarily create effort. Researchers actually need to show up, and they have to be able to do their jobs. When Dr. Meng started in this field, the best batteries powered a 10-pound laptop for an hour. Now we have cell phones, laptops, cars, and watches all powered on batteries, sometimes all day. And that's a huge leap, but we can leap more.
If we invest 1% of our world economy, 1% for energy storage, we'll get there in 10 years.
10 years if we invest 1% of the world economy. In 2023, the GDP of Earth is estimated to be $105 trillion. If we take $1 trillion annually and invest it into battery research, we'd have everything we just talked about by 2033. Think about that for a minute. The Trump tax cuts cost $2 trillion. The 20-year failed war on terror cost $8 trillion. If that doesn't make you a little bit, I'd trade all that for a house whose walls could store electricity and a jet powered by battery. Oh, I didn't tell you about the jet.
Maybe in the future, we would say electric cars per charge is going to drive 600 miles instead of 300. We can also potentially enable flying cars, right? Vertical lift and the travel. So it will no longer be science fiction in the Hollywood movie. It will be reality.
Flying batteries is wild enough to think about, but the average car going 600 miles? That's like grabbing a Dunkin' in Boston, driving to New York for a slice, then popping down to DC to get a half smoke, and then driving back to Philadelphia to have a cheesesteak. All on one charge, which is good because after that you're gonna need a pretty big nap. In the end though, I know why you care about batteries. I know why we all do. Because whether we are conscious of it or not, we get that without batteries, we're up a creek without an impeller. We need batteries to power nearly everything in our lives. And in 20 years, it's gonna be more important, not less. Thank you to Dr. Shirley Meng for coming on and adding some perspective to our battery hype.
The Argon communication person did tell me that if Trace asks you to talk to him, you should do it.
Oh, wow.
I, for one, am looking forward to our battery-constructed homes. That would be truly amazing. But what about you? Wearables? Let me know, and thanks for watching. But before you hop, batteries are a huge part of how we interact, but they don't have to be. Some of my happiest memories involve playing games with my family or my friends. And although I have to admit I'm not actually that competitive, I do like games where playing is more fun than winning. In my favorite games, the players work together to win, like, you know, Dungeons and Dragons, but not everyone has time to set up a whole campaign. So when Clarendon Games pinged me about priorities, I was intrigued. It's a cooperative party game of absurd choices. And I was like, check, 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 check. The game is actually really simple. I played it with some friends the other night. You draw some cards and you secretly rank them in order of your priorities from love to loathe. And what's more important to you, for example, friendship, climate change, or Hawaiian pizza. On our game, we had hip hop, bankers, or diarrhea. Like pretty easy choices, it seems like, but we didn't get them all right. Once you've ranked, everyone else has to guess the order that the person chose. Every card they get right, they keep, and of course, you're trying to spell priorities. It's quick to learn, doesn't require any trivia except about you, and everyone wins while you learn about each other. Priorities just hit stores in the US. It's actually a UK-based game. If you like being the first to intro a new game to your friends, which I know I do, swing by Target and pick one up. They sent us one to try. It was so fun. And also, I was surprised because I played it with the clones too, how much we varied from the clones. It's almost like they're people. Almost. Anyway, grab a copy of Priorities for your next game night. It's easy to learn and perfect for friends or family. Again, in the US, just pop over to Target, brand new. You can get it there. There's a link down in the description if you want to learn more. And thanks for listening. Ultimately, I'm just a video creator standing in front of the audience and saying, tell me what you want. If you have a question about the world and you want me to answer it in a video like this, send it to me. There's a link in the description. I want to be the guy you think of when Google or Wikipedia fail you. I can help. I can be your smart friend. Bottom line though, I'm happy you're watching, so apropos of nothing, thank you for being here. Thanks to my patrons, thanks to my friends, thanks to you, and from a standing position for the first time in years, as always, more research is needed.